before speaking, sentence construction is mangled, ideas are mistranslated, and offenses are sometimes made. Using an accordion structure of various color papers, the front side of the pages contain the main text, which is then scrolled out with machine sewing to also connect the pages together. The result is a small book that doesn't sit quite right, just as misspoken words can sometimes do. The back side of the book contains the quiet thoughts that occur during these uncomfortable conversations. I wanted the book to physically express awkwardness, so I chose a fancy display font because it looks terrible and it's difficult to read. The thread that connects the pages together is sewn directly across every page, connecting at just one or two points. This makes it a little awkward to hold and read as it can tend to twist and flop a bit. Because the binding causes the book to sit in a teetering little pile, it comes nestled in a small box. Now I'll read the text. So it's very small. Pull it open. It says, sometimes when I talk, my words don't come out quite right. I'm not as stupid as I sound, and I don't mean to offend. Shut up, I tell myself. Stop talking, but I can't help it. I am awkward. And then back reads, what did I say? Why did I say that? I wish I hadn't said that. I wish I had said that differently. That's not what I meant. What I meant to say was, oh, why did I say that? I should stop talking. I won't say anything else. I'll just smile and nod. But I should say something. What should I say? No, I can't say that. If I say it like, no, that sounds dumb. Or maybe I could say, no, that sounds dumb too. I'll just be quiet. The next book is called The Shape of Absence, and it's one of two books that I started during an artist residency at In Cahoots in Petaluma, California. This was in 2019. And completed this in 2020, and it describes the heartbreaking process of the end of a relationship. The title comes from an ex-boyfriend and was created during the end of our relationship. For this book, I had a general idea of what I wanted to do, but needed to work out the details before I left my residency. First, I did some writing, ruminating on the phrase, the shape of the absence to understand what you are missing, which is something this ex-boyfriend once said to me. I thought it was a nice phrase at the time, but it took an entirely different meaning when I got to making this book. Using the text from a writing, I made three spontaneous books. Spontaneous bookmaking is a method of working I really enjoy. I use this method to generate or work through ideas, or just to get my creative brain warmed up at night. I played with the text, which words to use, and where they should go. I also played a little with the page structure, how many pages there should be, and how they would turn, how turning the pages would enhance or distract from the meaning of the text. Once I made these decisions, I purchased and trimmed my paper before heading down to California. The background was pressure printing using imagery inspired by the boyfriend's triangular nose. I cut out a triangle shape to use as a template for drawing overlapping triangles of various sizes. I drew these triangles onto sheets of paper that would serve as a pressure printing place. Then I pierced holes equidistant from each other and sewed along the lines of embroidered glass. These pressure printing plates were used to print the background for both sides of the three signatures that made up the book. Plus the front cover and blind printed texture for the end sheets. Eight unnecessarily time-consuming runs in all. That's the press I printed on. After I returned home, I began working on printing the text in the rich red circle in the center of the book. To begin the center image, I drew a circle the size I wanted it to be, which was about 3 1/4 inches or 20 pipettes. Then I randomly placed some pipe around it printed the text, including the cover and polyfon. So far, the shapes to create a shape were 1. Pressure print, 2. Print the center image, 3. Print the text. But then I decided I wanted just a little more visual texture, so I decided to create a new step, 4. Pierce a bunch of holes in a similar triangular manner as the pressure printing, because who doesn't love some details? I drew all new triangles and traced them onto some clear thick plastic to use as piercing templates. I pierced the holes an eighth of an inch apart, and for funsies, I counted the holes on each template. They added up to 891. The next step was 5, hand trim the folio so I can fold and stitch them together. And here they all are, getting defoliated. And this is the final look. When viewing the book, each page unfolds one at a time. It's not turning each page. The first and last spreads have pages that unfold upward and downward to reveal text. The center spread has pages that open outward to reveal more text. And this is how I intended shape to be viewed and for the text to be read clockwise, beginning at reflection on the left. So the book reads, reflection, doubt, clarification, empty arms, longing, pain, what is the shape of absence? The second book I started during my residency, The Saga of Girl and Boy, is not quite finished, so it's not included in this show. Saga also began with a spontaneous book, which you'll see is kind of a theme here. Started with a spontaneous book, which began with spontaneous printing, which began with this quick proof print I made one day during my letterpress class. My notes there say, print layers of these things on 17-pound vellum or other transparent stuff. Loop layouts a lot, then can use sheets used for 1 hour book fodder. Then he made 2 separate colors. I created imagery using my beloved wood bits made by virgin wood type that my good friend Sasha gifted me. Hi, Sasha. For the spontaneous printing, I arranged them haphazardly on the press and printed on onion skin using black carbon paper instead of ink. Then I added some geometric shapes and 2 pieces of metal type and red carbon paper. A story emerged. When I began working on Saga during my residency, the first thing I did was count and separate my trim stack of paper into 13 equal smaller stacks, 1 to use for each folio. This is an image of the wood bits on the press. I plan to print the background in 2 patches using the same wood bits and pieces I used for the spontaneous printing exercise that inspired this book. Saga has 52 pages, which is 52 passes through the press and printing 2 layers on each side, which is a lot of printing. I set up a quick registration template on the press with tape so I could vary the layout on every folio. This template allowed me to complete each pass in about 10 minutes, including setting up the wood. Still, the printing took 2 entire days. After the background was finished, I decided the foreground needed to wait until I was back in Seattle. I carefully labeled each folio with the page number it contained and set them aside. They still look like that too, by the way. I started working on the foreground the day after I returned to Seattle. I printed the metal type on a CMP flatten press. The Saga is printed on Sakishu, which is a very thin and delicate Japanese paper. I had to string rubber bands across the quivers to help I use the same wood bits as on the inside pages because consistency. This comment printed on the button cuffs. I set up a template in the chase, similar to what I did on the Vanderbilt portfolios, and printed four sets of cover sheets. After making several mock-ups and talking to some friends, I think I finally have the binding figured out. I just need to do some more mock-ups. So, this is kind of what the cover will look like. But the this is kind of what the inside will look like. But it'll be better. And here's a shortened version of the story. Artistic reawakening. In the four times, I had three jobs. A full-time job at a printing company, plus teaching letterpress once a week at Pratt Fine Arts Center, plus custom letterpress printing, mostly for weddings. My full-time job slowed drastically, so we moved to a three-day work week. Pratt closed. Weddings were postponed. I suddenly had a full 40 weekend to myself, so I spent some of this extra time in my studio to explore and play. I have a few typewriters, or more accurately, I have a small crap ton of typewriters. Also, my boyfriend thinks I will laugh years later at what I bought as a small crap ton of typewriters. One thing I did during this time was take patterns using different typewriters, colored ribbon, and colored carbon paper onto various translucent papers. And then I keep a little sample of it and paste it into my sketchbook. So this is. My most recent book in the show was created during this early pandemic time. Color Stitch is a spontaneous book that eventually inspired a suite of 20 works on paper using machine sewing, watercolor, and typewriter collage. I started with an old etching I made in undergrad of a spider element. I tore this print down 12 by 16 to utilize just the image area. This is a similar print using the same etching plate, except this one had the unfortunate addition of this really hideous pink. I tore this 12 by 16 sheet down to 4 6 by 4 signatures and traced the spider elephant image on the back using watercolors. These next photos show the entire book, page by page, including some detail shots. The torn down sheet resulted in three signatures of abstract shapes. That was four. No, it's three. Whatever. It's right behind Nick and Chad. Anyway, abstract shapes created by the spider legs. I experimented with different ways of filling in some of those shapes, using watercolor, hand-sewn Sashiko thread, and typewriter pattern collage. There's also a little crayon rub in there, too. I another spontaneous book I made last year. It's called Misaligned. It's not in the show because I love it and I want to keep it. It was typewritten on the translucent papers because I wanted the layers of the lines to show through, to overlap and intersect each other. I used three typewriters for this book: Hermy 2000, an Olympia SM4, and the Smith Corona Slim Super. I wouldn't have been sure of that. Each signature is typed on one side in two colors. Forget that. This book is 16 pages, comprised of two sheets each of glassine and tracing paper, plus a mylar cover. Each signature is typed on one side in two colors. With a little bit of collage added to one of both sides. The collage paper, of course, comes from my growing stack of pattern types and tracing paper. Mylar cover. And that. With all this extra time I had during quarantine, I had to put out, or I decided to put out a call to see if anyone would be interested in making some collaborative spontaneous books with me. I posted this on Instagram and received 20 responses. I started 15 books and have 4 completed. And this is the post I put on Instagram. Hey, I have this idea. Would you like to make a collaborative book with me? We'll work spontaneously for 1 hour, then mail them to each other, work on each other's book, and then mail them back. Now I'm messaging me. So these next images are from one of those exchanges I did. It's one of my favorites, and I did this exchange with Virginia Humbaycock, who's really fabulous. She's an etching artist, and she's lovely. We did this book 2 rounds each. So this is what I sent to her. There's a drawing, some collage, and typewritten lines, and some sewing too. little bit on the top to match the marketing, which is nice. That's a detail. And then this is what she sent me. She sent me several sheets of this, of these indigo photo print things. My first step was to make them two-sided. They were all just printed on the front side and the back to all links. I didn't like that. So I cut them up and attached them with some of my typewriter pattern paper. Using my blue, of course, to go with the blue that she started with. She started this book, so she kept this book. That was an extra one, I wasn't sure what to do with. And then this is the final book, named The Color Blue. She added some text in there. The blue at the horizon, the blue of the land, the blue of land that seems to be dissolving into the sky is a deeper, dreamier, melancholy blue. The blue of the farthest reaches of the places where you see for miles. The blue of the affirmance. Darkness? It was darkness. The light that does not touch us, does not travel the whole distance. The light that gets lost gives us the beauty of the world, so much of which is in the color blue, which was written by Rebecca Solnit on a field guide to getting lost.
Confusion of moving, I mean, it's challenging. Has it affected how much letterpress work you personally are doing versus what you were doing?
Yes, definitely. Yes.
Okay.
Since I usually print it at Pratt's and I can't do that anymore, last summer I was forced to use my own presses, which is funny, I didn't really use them that much. So then when I moved them, one of them, I have
when you're first working on something, or do you think at all or a lot about multiple additions, or are you just not worrying about that? Is it something that crosses your mind in terms of how you do your work?
Uh-huh.
I'm just curious.
No, that's a good question. I think it depends on what it is.